real life, real music radio with your host, Kyle Hutton.
Well, welcome back. It's not your first time at Do-Si-Do. It's my first time to get to sit on stage with you, but it's definitely not your first time here. We're glad you're back.
Not my first time here, but this is the first time I think I felt like I walked onto a mini Opry stage when I hear that applause walking out here. I appreciate everybody being here, and thank you, Kyle, for letting me be on your show tonight.
Oh, man, it's a pleasure. I appreciate, you know, any time we can get somebody out to, you know, add a show on to their weekend run, I just appreciate you coming out midweek and spending the night with us here.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm glad to be here, and this Wednesday is just been kind of, you know, we were actually fixing to leave last night, and you can get a wrench thrown in the gears from time to time, and we usually come down here on the bus and look back there last night, and there was just this huge oil leak, so we had to just redo and rechange everything, and then we ended up taking the car. But hey, I wouldn't have missed this for anything in the world, man.
Well, I'll tell you what we'll try to do, Glen, since you guys are in the car and not the bus. I know you don't have much room to take that merch back with you, so we're going to see how much of it we can sell tonight before we get out of here. Well, listen, I'm going to have a bunch of questions for you tonight, but I wonder if you would just do what everybody came here to hear you do, and you just pick one that you want to play for us to kick us off tonight.
Yeah. Let's... Man, they already got everything plugged in. This ain't no sideshow act, man. Everything's all plugged in and ready to go.
You're ready. We got you ready.
So how about we start off? I always like to start out with something that's just a little bit kind of upbeat. And this is a song that we released earlier this year, back in late June, I believe it was. But for all the country people, a song called Countries You Want to Get, like this right here. Say you never met a guy like me with a small town grin, pinch a jaw in his cheek, and you're sick and tired of them boys round town that you grew up with. You wanna get on down with them hound dog hunting, cornbread loving, down on the farm kind of man that could show you something. You want some damn straight, you want some yeehaw. Well, you could take a little bite or have a whole hog. Trading them you guys for a hey y'all. I bet you sound real sweet with a southern drawl. If you're looking for some fun and you wanna get you some, I'm your redneck, and we can get as country as you wanna get. I could take you on a mud-covered ride, flying all jacked up with you sitting up high. And I could see you in a pair of cut-off jeans, honeysuckle in your hair, baby, you and me on a haystack hugging, cold beer chugging, hillbilly kind of night that'll get your country bumping. You want some damn straight, you want some yeehaw. Well, you could take a little bite or have a whole hog. Trading them you guys for a hey y'all. I bet you sound real sweet with a southern drawl. If you're looking for some fun and you wanna get you some, I'm your redneck, and we can get as country as you wanna get. You want some damn straight, you want some yeehaw. Why take a bite, girl, when you could have a whole hog? Trading them you guys for a hey y'all. I bet you sound real sweet with a Texas drawl. You want some damn straight, you want some yeehaw. Why take a bite, girl, when you could have a whole hog? Trading them you guys for a hey y'all. I bet you sound real sweet with a southern drawl. If you're looking for some fun and you wanna get you some, I'm your redneck. Yeah, we can get as country as you wanna get. Yeah, we can get as country as you wanna get. Yeah, we can get as country as you want to get.
All right. Thank you. Sometimes this thing sounds better when it's tuned up.
Well, it sounded pretty good to us Texas folks here tonight. So, man, okay, so the first question I want to ask you is from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, right? How did you first find your way to Texas? And I know you play here a lot now, and we love that. But tell us a little bit about Tuscaloosa, Alabama, how you got started and wound up on stages like you are tonight.
Well, my dad was a huge musical inspiration in my life. And when he returned from Vietnam, he started singing in gospel quartets. And I remember as a kid going into when he went from gospel quartets, and then he went into like he was playing in like VFWs and American Legions and things like that, some of the places that I play now. And I remember when he would walk in, people would just, it was like the room got lifted up. And I always wanted, just as a young man, I wanted to follow in the footsteps of my dad. And he was just such a big musical influence to me. And he was playing there all around town, and we heard through the grapevine that this lady had been out and kind of heard me singing some open mic night and some karaoke night stuff. Anybody sing karaoke in here? And you've had a few? So I had this one song that I always go to when I was doing karaoke, and somehow or another she had gotten word that I was a kind of following the footsteps of my dad. And she's like, you know what, I got some connections in Nashville if you want to take the move to move up there. And so I was like, it's either now or never. My daddy said, look, that woman's been trying to get in touch with you. If you're going to do this, you need to do it right now, or you just need to sell everything you got. I mean, that ain't the exact words he used, but he said, just sell your you-know-what, and you just need to get out of it completely. So I took the leap. Went to Nashville, started playing on Broadway at a little local honky-tonk there called Tootsie's Organ Lounge. And if anybody's ever been to Nashville, they know about Tootsie's. And I played there for almost 2 years. And there was almost like a recruiter who came in from Cowboys in Arlington, Texas. And he was there in Tootsie's one night. He's like, you know, we're looking for a front man to front the house band there in Dallas, in Arlington. And if you would come out and just do an audition for us, we'd love it. So that was kind of my first step out into Texas. And I really got out here and got introduced to some of the best live music crowds that I've ever experienced. We're right here. And yeah, hats off to all of you for always making this possible for me. And so here I've been now off and on. I played that for about 6 months, doing that circuit from Cowboys there in Arlington over to Dallas Red River and down into San Antonio at the Cowboys there off I-10. And ever since then, I've just always been, I'm kind of like the orphan child of Texas country music, because I know that I knew this about Texas, that down here, if you ain't from Texas, you bad God, you ain't supposed to be here. And I was an exception to that rule, because I just got open arms. You guys invited me in. So thank you so much.
All right. Well, I want to ask you, because you do have fans here in Texas and we love to support the music that you put out, I want to ask you about the most recent single that you had out called Cutoffs. I wonder if you'd tell us about that one and play that song for us.
Well, yeah, let's play. Let's do play. They were faded blue like a summer sky, all soaking wet, fitting real tight. A pair of 501 worn out hand-me-down Levi's, a frayed cotton edge split all the way up to the button fly. Well, I remember them cutoffs, clear as a bell,
can't say much about nothing else. She had tan legs and man, they were long. Tupelo honey dripping southern draw. But them cutoffs really filled my tank. Swinging out over that riverbank was a bona fide country girl, shocking all, no doubt at all. I remember them cutoffs. A little later on, sun going down, we built a little fire, started making out. I couldn't tell you where we were or what we talked about. Oh, but what I'll never forget is what started the whole thing out. I remember them cutoffs, clear as a bell. Can't say much about nothing else. She had tan legs and man, they were long. Tupelo honey dripping southern draw. But them cutoffs really filled my tank. Swinging out over that riverbank was a bona fide country girl, shocking all, no doubt at all. I remember them cutoffs. Whoa, she was drop dead corn fit, sure enough fine. Whoa, when I think about her after all this time, I remember them cutoffs. Clear as a bell, can't say much about nothing else. She had tan legs and man, they were long. Tupelo honey dripping southern draw. But them cutoffs really filled my tank. Swinging out over that riverbank was a bona fide country girl, shocking all, no doubt at all. I remember them cutoffs. Still sounds new to me.
Some songs just don't need that much explanation, do they?
That was a well-written song by Troy Johnson, man. When I first heard that song, I was just like, man, that's so groovy, the groove to it. And you know what sells me before anything is like, how does the music make me feel before I ever hear a lyric? And that one was just something that, and my wife and I were riding down the road, and I was just like, you know what, that thing just, it just really makes me feel good. You know, it kind of makes me want to get up and get out of my seat. And you see me up here just moving around when I'm playing. And it's just one of those tunes that I just, yeah. I couldn't get it out of my head.
Yeah, yeah. So how many, just to give people perspective, when you're listening to songs that other people have written, how many songs do you typically listen to, do you think, before you pick one, right? Like, your wife and you are riding around listening to that song, right? Well, if you're putting together an album or putting together an EP, how many songs are you going to listen through before you decide the ones you're going to bring to our listening ears?
As many as it takes.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, if it rolls around first, if I hear it first, and if it moves me, it's the first one, I'm going to record it. So it just kind of depends on, you know, and I think it kind of depends on what kind of mood you're in that day. If it really sits with you the first time that you hear it, that's kind of a big determining factor too. You know, yeah. It's just where you come from, where you're going. And so, I mean, I've listened of all the songs that I've recorded, and probably 50 songs that I've recorded, maybe even... probably 50 songs, 60 maybe. Yeah. And out of those songs that I've recorded, I've probably listened to, thousands, probably 15,000 songs,
yeah.
You know. And sometimes I don't get all the way through a song. Sometimes it's just like first verse and chorus. And then I'm like, well, you know, it's just not sitting with me, and it's just not the right one for me. Not that it's a bad song. Just may not be right for me.
Yeah, yeah. No, I don't know. We have any songwriters in the audience? Anybody in here ever written a song? Anybody? No?
Empty-handed.
Oh, yes, they have. Steve, the owner of Do-Si-Do, he's written songs. Christy, have you ever written a song? Nothing you would talk. Well, that's okay. You know, the whole songwriting thing is just a very interesting. If you're a music fan and you wonder how the product gets made, you know what I mean? It's a really interesting thing. I mean, an artist, if you're a songwriter and you're trying to get Glen Templeton to record a song, he's listening to a stack of songs this big to whittle it down to the next single or whatever he's going to put out, right? Exactly. Which is a kind of an interesting part of the process. Now, so let's go back. You've put out some singles that have been more recent, but let's go back to California, the full length record that you put out in 2019. Right. Tell me about that record. Tell me about that collection of songs and maybe kind of where you were at when you put it together, and then pick one of your favorite ones off that record.
Well, the song California, was, and the album itself was an album that we put together off of a Kickstarter program, and we had a lot of songs that we'd piled up, didn't quite have the budget to go in and record them. And so one of our friends in the industry said, you know, Glenn, you guys should do one of those Kickstarter programs. And I don't know, we may have some of our Kickstarter people in here tonight. We got one right there for sure, yeah. And so we put out a Kickstarter campaign and exceeded, you know, what we thought we were going to get to be able to finish the record up, and we ended up being able to get the record, get the artwork done, get the album completed, packaged, and put out to market. Wow. And it was just, and in the beginning, you know, I was just like, well, you know, I don't really know if I want to really put something other out, but it turned out to be something that we felt like was very organic and very, very true to who we are. And then again, I started rethinking about it. I was like, you know, This would be really good for us to title this California, and in honor of my daddy, who was such a musical inspiration for me. And so my favorite song on the album is the song California. So how about it?
Let's hear it.
Yeah. Now, my daddy recorded this song back in the late 1970s, early 80s, and started putting it out in the early 80s. And he played it more down here in Texas than anywhere. So it kind of brings it full circle, doesn't it? Said she's going to California with some old guy that she don't know. Said she's going there to live a while. His life in Alabama's way too slow. You know I'll always love her. She used to call me on the phone. I did all I could for her. I just turned and she was gone. Must have been one of those magazines, salesman door to door. All I know is how she left me. I'm never gonna see her smiling face no more. I feel the touch of her fingers. Walk the streets all alone. Did all I could for her. I just turned and she was gone. I just turned and she was gone. Said she's going to California with some old guy that she don't know. Said she's going there to live a while. His life in Alabama's way too slow. You know I'll always love her. She used to call me on the phone. I did all I could. could for her. I just turned and she was gone. I just turned and she was gone. Thank you very much. Thank y'all. Thank you.
Man, so okay. Listening to you sing that, I can't let that one go without another question or two. So when you sing that one, I mean, I would imagine there's kind of a connection to Dad, and there's something there that's probably a little more special than some of the other songs that you sing. Tell us a little more about the influence that he had on you musically, and just as the man you are today, and anything else you want to say about him after that song?
Well, you know, my dad was obviously a huge musical influence, not only to me, but to a lot of people. And he was a very gentle soul, and you know, he got back from Vietnam, and he lived with PTSD and just battled it, you know, up until his last day.
Yeah.
And it was a tough time. It was, you know, a really hard thing to swallow, watching him go the way that he went. And it was just you know, it's one of those ones that it never heals, you know, that part of me, it never heals. But over time, I feel like I'm living out a dream that he had once in his life, and I feel like I get to live that out, you know, at the same time. And a connection remains forever because of it.
Yeah. Well, thanks for sharing that song with us, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. That's great. Yeah. So let's talk about another thing that I know. And you don't have to look far in your musical catalog or at the pictures that are out there on your website and that kind of stuff, at your headband, at your T-shirt. You don't have to look too deep to understand that patriotism is an important thing to you. And the people that make this country, that the people that make this country what it is, and those are the people that are the servants, the people out there serving us and enabling us to be here tonight, is important to you. And you put out a single not too long ago. It's got an amazing accompanying video that pays tribute to the men in blue. And I just wonder if you'd tell us a little bit about where that patriotism comes from for you, and maybe some of your thoughts on those people that are serving for us, and play that song for us.
Well, you know, I don't hold the honor of being in the military. I'm not a hero. That's not an honor that I hold. But I do love the greatest country in the world, and I'm so grateful to be here and to be a part of what so many people have laid down their lives in order for us to be able to do what we do and live as free Americans and provide that blanket of freedom that we all get to live beneath. And sometimes, even for myself, it can all be taken for granted. You know, we think something's not going right today, or, you know, I'm stuck in 5 o'clock traffic, or, and it's the small things like that. And we forget about, you know, at that moment, you know, what the sacrifices that have been paid long before us, and not just, I mean, in every single war, and not only the wars overseas, but the wars here on our home streets, you know. And so when I wrote this song, this thing started back years ago, and I had this idea, you know, because there were so many out there who are fighting and serving for our freedom, and Boys in Blue was just a term that we use, you know, in honor of all of those who law enforcement. It's just like, you know, the Boys in Blue. Yeah. And it was a genial term. And so some people would some, I've had a couple of people say, well, what about the women in blue? And it's for you too. It's for you too. Because we do have females out there who are serving and fighting for us and who will be willing to take a bullet for us as well. And firefighters. And we've got, you know, doctors and nurses who are just on the front lines for us at all times. But this song was one that I was like, you know, I need to write something that just has some sort of a patriotic something to it, that we need to stand up for what we believe in. And the producer that I was working with at the time, he told me, he said, Glenn, he said, I don't know what to tell you other than we need a song for the police officers. And I said, I started one a long time ago, and I said, I need to finish it up. And so I finished up Boys in Blue. Here's to the citizens on patrol, sworn to protect and serve, who stand in the line of fire, even if it hurts. For the heroes on the streets of our hometowns and in between, we salute. I read white and boys in blue when the shots are fired in the dead of the night. When the screams ring out and the babies cry, for those who risk it all, no matter what the cost, together and forever we salute our red, white, and boys in blue. They're the 24/7, 365, down to suit up, lay it on the line. All those who lend a helping hand, stand in honor of our great land with a thin blue line that says we'll sleep in peace tonight when the shots are fired in the dead of the night. When the screams ring out and the babies cry, for those who risk it all, no matter what the cost, together and forever we salute our red, white, and boys in blue. Here's to the citizens on patrol, sworn to protect and serve, who stand in the line of fire, even if it hurts. God bless all those law enforcement people out there.
Very nice.
You know, I tried to write that thing with a couple of different people, and it just never turned out how I wanted to. You know how when you take and write a song, and you go there and you go, you know what, this just didn't turn out how I felt like it should. And then I just go back to the drawing board and just rethink on it and try to put the best that I can into it.
Yeah.
And, I don't hold the honor of serving in a military or in a police force, but I try to pay my tribute through the grace of God and what He's given me to be able to share.
Yeah, well, that's a great song. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So talking about songwriting. So tell me, you've told us that when you're listening to a song and you're listening for songs, usually you're listening to the music and the way it makes you feel. Same thing when you're writing a song, or does it usually start for a lyric with you? Tell us a little bit about the writing process of Glen Templeton.
The writing process starts a little bit different. I mean, it can be either or. Typically what you hear when you hear a song that's played for you is like a you'll start hearing the jingle to it. You hear a work tape, so you kind of hear the jingle to it, and if the jingle catches, you know, your ear, and it sounds a little bit like ear candy, and it's like, oh, man, you know, this song sounds familiar in some way, so I'll continue to listen. And but for writing a song, I just, you know, sometimes it comes with just, you know, a word being said or something being said, just in general terms. I mean, kind of like, you know, I wrote this song for my bride, and the way that I wrote it was, you know, I was just looking at, on the top of my favorites list on my phone was my wife's name, and rightfully so, right? Yeah. It just says, my wife got two hearts by it. And, you know, when I asked Siri to call my wife, she says, calling my wife two hearts. And I was like, you know, she's my favorite. If I'm gonna fight with somebody, I'm gonna fight with her. If I'm gonna agree with somebody, I'm gonna agree with her. If I'm gonna go to the end of my days with somebody, it's gonna be her.
Yeah.
And so she's my favorite everything. So I wrote a song called My Favorite.
Yeah.
For her. And I'm sure she wouldn't mind if I played it for y'all right now. Like an old familiar song, a wide open road to roam, or a cool dip on the coast in mid-July. Like a faded photograph taped up on the dash, still holding strong after all this time. Like a worn out pair of jeans, torn at every seam, it somehow seems to always fit just right. Baby, you're my favorite, taste of love and my undying craving. You're my habit forming crush, and you're the bittersweet reasons for these hurt so good feelings. And every moment in my life worth replaying. Oh, baby, you're my favorite. The way you smile through the tears you cry, the way you whisper your goodnights, the way you press your lips to mine, show me the calm and get me signs, and then wake me every morning to start the day off right. Baby, you're my favorite, taste of love and my undying craving. You're my habit forming crush, and you're the bittersweet reasons for these hurt so good feelings. And every moment in my life worth replaying. Oh, baby, you're my favorite thoughts, midnight pillow talks, and the emotions running wild, I can't help chasing. You're my favorite, taste of love and my undying craving. You're my habit forming crush, and you're the bittersweet reasons for these hurt so good feelings. And every moment in my life worth replaying. Oh, baby, oh, baby, you're my favorite, my favorite.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very nice. So How long have you been married, Glen?
12 years.
12 years. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
12 years. That's good. I've been married. I've been married 27 years, and I wrote a song for my wife called "If You Want to Be My Lover, Stop Acting Like My Mother." It didn't go over as well. It didn't go over as well as that one. I promise you. I might play you one. Yeah.
Do we want to hear it?
I don't.
I mean, I do. Oh, he's got his own axe.
Okay.
We need to hear this.
I already have to start qualifying and apologizing before I even play it. So this song, I wrote this. I started collecting all of those little, you know, the sweet things my wife says to me repetitively. And I realized that... I had enough of them to write a song, and so that's kind of what I did here. And she's not here tonight, so I'll play it for y'all.
I think she might be watching, though. She might see this.
She'll see it later. All right, let me see what I got here. Yeah, okay. Let's see if I remember this one. So, it goes something like this. Pick up your shoes, wash your face, and brush your teeth, and don't be late. Don't stay out all night with your friends. Because you come in drunk and think you're funny, but my floors are clean and your boots are muddy, and this morning you forgot the trash again. So I said, if you want to be my lover, stop acting like my mother, because it freaks me out and leaves me so confused. Yeah, I don't know whether to hug you or lay you down and love you. Yeah, babe, it's up to you. You'll have to choose. Yeah, I want to see you in a satin gown in the bedroom playing around. Come on, girl, and flash me that pretty smile. Put on your come get me pumps. Let's get this cowboy jump and let's do something we ain't done in a while. Yeah, if you wanna be my lover, stop acting like my mother, cause it freaks me out and leaves me so confused. Yeah, I don't know whether to hug you or lay you down and love you. Yeah, babe, it's up to you. You'll have to choose. Now, you can imagine at this point, I'm like, I have no idea how I'm going to land this plane, or if I should. So this is the best I could come up with for a last verse right here. I got the perfect plan, I think, to redirect your motherly instinct and keep you from going off like you just did. What we need is a little alone time, a hot bath and a bottle of red wine. Slip off to bed, and we'll get you a kid. Cause if you wanna be my lover, stop acting like my mother, cause it freaks me out and leaves me so confused. Yeah, I don't know whether to hug you or lay you down and love you. Yeah, babe, it's up to you. You'll have to choose. Ooh, yeah, babe, it's up to you. You'll have to choose.
Yeah. Yeah, Kyle.
I'm sorry, sweetheart.
You didn't raise your hand when you asked about other songwriters in here.
Yeah. Oh, man. Yeah, that's fun. That's actually where that came from was we were. Well, let me just say this: how many of
we
you
know
ate,
where it came?
How many of you ate the? How many of you ate the chicken fried steak at Do-Si-Do tonight? A few of you eat the chicken fried steak. Okay, Now, normally, if I'm at a place like Duck, you know, I'm going to order the chicken fried steak, and I normally do that. Well, one day, I went out to lunch with my wife, and we were at Jason's Deli. Do you remember back when we used to have salad bars? Do we still have maybe the salad bars back out at Do-Si-Do? I don't know. We went for a long time without salad bars. Well, anyway, we're at the salad bar. We're at Jason's Deli, and we're ordering. And she says, well, I'll have the salad bar. And then the guy says, what do you want? And usually I get the sandwich with the most meat on it and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I said, well, I think today I'll have a salad bar. And she looked at me like, ooh, that's my man. Got him a salad bar. And we get over to the salad bar, and I'm about to go through and start getting my stuff. And she goes, the spinach is healthier.
It's never good enough.
And I looked right across that, you know, whatever they call that, spit guard or whatever that is. And I said, if you want to be my lover, stop acting like my mother. And then I grabbed the Jason's Deli napkin, and I wrote that down real fast and put it in my pocket.
And that's, so
that's
how
where
start.
That song came from.
That's how they start,
that's
right?
That's how they start sometimes.
Yeah.
All right. So enough about that. Thank you all for humoring me.
One more time.
One.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. So let's do this real quick while I've thrown us completely off track. We need a liner to start the radio program with. So if you will say, this is Glen Templeton, and this is Real Life, Real Music. Then you guys are going to go absolutely nuts, okay, for about 4 minutes, and then I'm going to have you no, not that long. I'll go like this when we're done, but if you give us that liner, this is Glen Templeton, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Hey, everybody, this is Glen Templeton, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Perfect. Man, y'all killed that. Y'all killed that. Okay.
Wow.
So before I distracted us with that with that last song, I was going to ask you about another song here that I wanted to talk about. Because, you know, you can't get far from talking about patriotic stuff without dovetailing right into the conversation about cowboys, mm-hmm. right? And you had a song called Code of the Cowboy that was one of your most recent singles.
Right.
Man, tell us about that one and play that for us. I know being in country music, we're around cowboys all the time. Has that been part of your life growing up? Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, you know, I never really got introduced to the cowboy way of life. I think everybody, you know, as a kid, we all see cowboys and Indians, and it's some you want to be the cowboy. You always see him as being the good guy, and what I've learned is that most of the time, that's true. There's a lot of cowboys out there who are just will stand up. They think about their fellow man before they think about themselves. They're willing to lend a helping hand to their neighbor and help them stand a wall up at their house or roof it or dig a ditch or something long before they ever think about themselves. And I was out at an event out in Fort Worth, Texas, an organization called Cowboys Helping Cowboys, and I was invited to come out there. And this is when I really saw like the behind the scenes of the cowboys and what their way of life really, what they really stood for, other than just what we see them standing for when they're in the arena just riding and roping. And we've all seen that, but what I'd never experienced was the cowboy behind the scenes. And I got there and they had these silent auctions, and the organization was for fallen cowboys who couldn't work anymore, who were maybe physically disabled. They'd lost a little family members, they'd lost. It was for whatever the cause. And I really saw the workings of nothing more than just a hand of Jesus, just lending out to other people. And that was coming by way of cowboys, just extending their hand to say, look, we're here to help in any way. And that silent auction, they raised so much money. And, you know, you see these people who are just, they're just overwhelmed with joy. And I was like, you know, these are some of the things. This is like, this is the code of a cowboy, is to do these things first. You know, is to hold on tight to your mama's hand, you know, to be there regardless. I mean, put everything else aside and you're there for your fellow man. And that's just what I thought was just the code of a cowboy. And the way the song started out was, the morning after I'd played the event, we came downstairs and there was this feller down there, and you could tell he'd had a pretty long night. Y'all know what I mean. He'd had a pretty long night, and he'd probably been riding and roping, but he was down there, and I saw him doing that. You know, he was kind of doing that right there, like, you know, I need an early morning drink. Yeah. You know, I need a little hair of the dog, you know. And I was like, man, that guy is, he's sweating whiskey through his calluses. And so that's how the intro of the song started, on Code of a Cowboy. So he'll sweat the fire of last night's whiskey through the calluses on his hands and hit his knees in the name of Jesus, amen, to being a better man. When his back's against the wall, he'll die upon the hill for a woman that he's always loved and always will. That's the code of a cowboy, ride on rope and the wind, and he'll saddle up for a greater cause. You call on one and you've got them all. That's the code of a cowboy. He keeps bread and water on the table, feeds the fire and warms the home, mends a shelter hanging overhead to weather any storm, rocks the babies in the evening before he lays down to rest, and holds on tight to mama's hand as she takes her last breath. That's the code cowboy, ride on rope in the wind, and he'll saddle up for a greater cause. You call on one and you've got them all. That's the code of a cowboy. So long live the way of life that are still alive and well, then tip your hat to never backing down and steady raising hell. That's the code of a cowboy, ride on rope in the wind, saddle up for a greater cause. You call on one and you've got us all. That's the code of a cowboy. The code of a cowboy.
Very nice. Yep.
Thank you.
That's a great song.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it. I need 10 million more. Oh, just like, man, you to say the same thing.
Yeah, no, that's a great song. I love that. Okay, so we have a lot of similarities. My dad came home from Vietnam and didn't talk about it a whole lot. And just now he's 81 years old and is just starting to kind of acknowledge that maybe there's something to this PTSD thing, and, you know, talk a little bit more about it. But you know, growing up, he wasn't the most vocal guy, but I knew that when it ever hit the fan, he always had my back. You know what I mean? And I'm setting up a story here because I want to describe the emotional impact it had. But so that was kind of my relationship with my dad. You know, always probably a little more distant than a little boy wants their relationship to be with their dad. But always knowing that if something happened, he'd be the first one there, right? And so Tara and I get married, and again, I've already told you how long we've been married, so this won't date me any more than that did. But we get into the limousine and we're leaving after the wedding's over. And the limo driver had the radio on, and we heard at that moment that Conway Twitty had passed away in the limo. And then guess what song they played? That's My Job. And she and I like bawled like babies in that limo. Because, you know, we just got married. We just, you know, our dads had just given us, you know, all that kind of stuff. And then boom, you find out one of your heroes is gone. And then they play the song that, man, growing up and hearing that song, That's My Job, I was like, that's me and my dad's song right there. You know what I mean? And then, dude, now, and listen, you're 100% Glen Templeton, but there's certain enunciations in what you do that haunt me. And
in
so,
a good way, I hope.
In a great way. So I want you to tell, first, I wonder if you would sing that song. And then after that, I want to talk a little bit more about Conway Twitty and how that's affected your life.
I would be honored to be able to sing you and your dad's song. I would. When I got to sing this song for the first time ever on live TV, was on Fox and Friends, and I'd flown to New York, and I don't really remember much about it other than just being on the stage, because there's a lot of getting ready and preparation and getting a news show ready. And it was early morning, it was like 5 a.m. Right. And that's just not musician time. This is not musician time. So we got there and we got ready. It was a whole band, and started playing the song, and it was on Father's Day.
Wow.
And they asked me to sing That's My Job, and I saw myself in the monitor up there, and then it was just me. And then all of a sudden, they slid to the side, and then it was my dad and I side by side. And man, it was, just fighting back to just, you know, just choking up. And so being said, I'd love to sing your dad's song.
Woke up crying late at night. I was very young. I had dreamed my father had passed away and gone. My world revolved around him. I couldn't lie there anymore. And so I made my way down the mirrored hall and tap upon his door. And I said, Daddy, I'm so afraid. How will I go on with you gone that way? Don't want to cry anymore, so may I stay with you. And he said, That's my job. That's what I do. Everything I do is because of you, to keep you safe with me.
That's my job, you see. Later we barely got along, this teenage boy and he. Most of the fights, it seemed, were over different dreams that we each held for me. He wanted knowledge and learning, I wanted to fly out west. Said I could make it out there if I just had the fare. I've got half, will you loan me the rest? And I said, Daddy, I'm so afraid. There's no guarantees in the plans I've made. And if I should fail, who will pay my way back home? And he said, that's my job. That's what I do. Everything I do is because of you, to keep you safe with me. That's my job, you see. Well, every person carves a spot and fills a hole with light, and I pray someday I might. Light as bright as he. I woke up early one bright fall day to spread the tragic news. And after all my travel, I'd settled down within a mile or two. I make my living with words and rhymes, and all this tragedy should go into my head and out instead as bits of poetry. But I say, Daddy, I'm so afraid. How will I go on with you gone this way? How could I come up with a song to say I love you? That's my job. That's what I do. Everything I do is because of you, to keep you safe with me. That's my job, you see. Yes, everything I do is because of you, to keep you safe with me.
Thank you all. Thank you all.
Yeah. Thank you. I hadn't listened to that song in a while, and hearing it, you know, man, such a great song, so powerful. I know that song's touched so many people, and you're helping keep it alive on the live stages, man. We appreciate you doing that. Yeah. So, man, I mean, tell me that the connection with Conway Twitty and with his family, and the honor that it must have been to be recognized by them and asked to participate in the play that was basically a tribute to him and his life. Tell us a little bit about that. That had to have just been such an honor for you.
Yeah, that is one of the biggest compliments that I get all the time is, man, you sound so much like Conway Twitty. I mean, someone who is such a staple for country music, a legend in country music, and who was just so great in his community with his family, and just the things he'd done within the community, and just a just a great, honorable man from what I understood, the stories that I heard. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I never heard anybody say anything, you know, bad about Conway. You know, it was always just, he's just a great singer. He's a great man. And he was a hero of mine as well. And, you know, my dad never really was a Conway Twitty fan.
Huh. All right.
But I was. And so I loved singing Conway stuff. And the way that I got into the role of Conway was, I don't know if you all remember a guy named Jared Neiman. Remember Jared Neiman?
Yep.
Yeah, he's still around. Jared, who just, you know, just a great songwriter and just can just flop songs out. And I'm not that kind of songwriter. You know, I mean, I hate those guys like that who can just sit down and, you know, 15 minutes later, they got a song. I'm not that guy. It takes me a little while to write a song. But he and a guy named Rob Hatch had written a song for Jeff Bates. And they would come down from time to time on Lower Broadway, that we call it, down to Tootsie's. And they'd get up on stage and sing. And, you know, they were songwriters and artists on the other end of the street, and I was a songwriter and an artist on the lower Broadway end of the street.
Yeah.
And but we got a, you know, a good musical connection between all of us, and they knew about me singing that Conway stuff and how much of a fan of his I was, and they were like, "Hey Glenn, we wrote this song for Jeff Bates. Do y'all remember Jeff Bates?" Who sounded so much like Conway Twitty. But Jeff just sounds like Conway Twitty when he sings. There's no, you know, he didn't rehearse the idea of sounding like, yeah, Conway Twitty as much as I did. And they brought me this song and I sang on it. And, you know, I don't play this song out very much.
Well, let's do it.
But they brought me this song, and then we had a man by the name of John Wesley Riles. And John Wesley has sang on everybody's, he sang backgrounds on everybody's records. I mean, millions and millions of copies from Alan Jackson, and he's always on Alan Jackson records and Kenny Chesney records and Tim McGraw records. And I mean, the list just goes on and on. Well, he came and sang the backgrounds on the demo for the song that I'd recorded. And little did we know, or little did I know at the time, that he was married to Joni Twitty, which was Conway's daughter. And so he went to my producer at the time and he said, "You know," he said, "that guy sounds so much like Conway." He said, "You know, they're putting together a musical where they're going to portray the life and the times and the music of Conway Twitty. And we'd like to, you know, let me run this by Joni, but let me see if we can't get him an audition. You know, do you think he's up for it?" And I talked with my producer, and he was like, "Man, it could be a great jump start for you." And I was like, "Yeah!" You know, I mean, at that time, I'm like 24, 25 years old, 26. Just in, you know, the prime of, yes, I'll whatever it takes, yeah, you know, whatever it takes to get there. And so they set me up a private audition, and I went down, and 2 weeks later, I got a call from the producer of the show, and he said, "You know what? We've been through thousands of people. You know, we had people in, we done some stuff in Vegas. We done some stuff in L.A. in auditions. We done some auditions in New York and in Branson, Missouri." And he said, we can't find nobody else who would want to play the Conway Twitty other than you." Wow. And man, What a huge mark that was for me. I mean, it was a great launch pad for my career. But the song, I'll play it for you, and I haven't played this in forever, so forgive me. Might want to cut the cameras off on this one.
I'm just kidding.
Keep it rolling. I
I see the way you look at me with the want to in your eyes. When I feel you hesitate, I know he's on your mind. I know you've never loved another man, but I'm here tonight to make you understand. I'll never be your first love, your first kiss, your first touch, but let me hold you while you let go of the past. No, I'll never be your first love, but I can be the last. Never thought you'd love again, but here we are right now. Nothing lying between us but these cotton sheets and a little bit of doubt. I want you to feel how much I care, so let down your guard when you let down your hair. I'll never first kiss, your first touch, but let me hold you while you let go of the past. No, I'll never be your first love, but I can be the last. And the morning sun will still be lying here as the days turn to months and the months turn to years. I'll never be your first love, your first kiss, your first touch, but let me hold you while you let go of the past. No, be your first love, but I can be the last. I'll never be your first love, but I can be the last.
It's been a minute, man.
Yeah.
Thank y'all.
Yeah.
Man, are y'all having a good time out there? Are we doing okay? All right. So, hey, I want to give one more big old round of applause for our season sponsors, the Griffin Realty Group and Chicago Title. Thank you guys for making nights like this possible because, man, I don't know about you, but I'm having a great, wonderful time.
Where are they at?
Right here, Griffin Realty Group. Y'all wave
Thank
your hands.
Thank you so much. Thank
Chicago
you.
Title. I don't know where those folks disappeared to. They're around here somewhere. But you know how it goes. When you're in show business, something to last 14 years, it's kind of like dog years, right? Dog
yeah.
years compared to people years, showbiz years compared to regular people years. So if we've done something 14 years, that's like 64 years that we've made this thing
really,
happen.
I thought you were going to say, yeah, I've been doing this about 2 years.
Man. Back,
and you started talking. I was like, he's been doing this a lot longer than 2 years.
Man.
He's too good at it.
I mean, and you would appreciate just because, you know, running up and down in Nashville, but I mean, Dean Dillon has sat there. Whispering Bill Anderson has sat there. You know, I could go down. Michael Martin Murphy, Larry Gatlin, BJ Thomas before he passed. We got to sit here and talk to him. And, man, everybody from, you know, Cody Johnson, when I paid him $250 to come do this show.
Oh, my gosh.
That boy won't come near me anymore. I don't know what. No, it's fun, man, because, you know, having the opportunity to talk to people about the music that they're passionate about. I mean, that's what this is for me and what it is for the people that come to these shows and the people that sponsor these shows. And man, we appreciate you being here. Okay, I'm not gonna direct you. I want you to just pick a song that you want to share with us. You just pick one that you want to lay on us.
Now, before I get into the song, you know, and I say this at every one of my shows because it comes from the bottom of my heart. When I was a kid and used to, just sit around and pick on the guitar and, dream about doing something like this and being in front of crowds like this in the great state of Texas that y'all are in, I want to say from the bottom of my heart, I'm thankful for each and every one of you so much for being a part of my dream coming true, mine and his both. Thank y'all so much for being here. Let me be a part of this. Thank you. Now, I'll have to say, I've got a lot of songs that I really love. Some of them I've recorded that I just kind of fell out of love with. I recorded them and I was like, meh.
All right.
Okay. It's good, But this song right here was a song that I grew up in a little Southern Baptist town right outside of Tuscaloosa, Alabama. And my meemaw raised me all my life. And I was raised old-fashioned. I'm talking about picking cotton and digging taters and snapping purple hull peas and, frying squash and okra together and we called them ice potatoes. But my meemaw raised me old fashioned and she raised me in a Southern Baptist church. She told me one time, Glenn, if you ever want to do anything playing guitar and singing, she said, I want you to learn to sing more songs for Jesus. Cause I was trying to learn all these country songs and everything. I want you to sing some more songs for Jesus. I took that inspiration to Nashville, and this is the first song that I ever got to actually put a vocal on, was this song right here. Well, thanks for another day that I don't deserve, and for helping me find my way around the curves. Cause the straight and narrow ain't the path I'm on, so help me keep it in the middle till I get back home. Cause I know I've strayed from side to side, sometimes I've even crossed the line, but I know where I'm going, and while I try to make it there, I hope God hears a sinner's prayer. Well, I mostly talk to you when I'm in a bind, rub against a mountain that I can't climb. Here I am again with trouble on my mind, hoping you'll help me one more time. Cause I know I've strayed from side to side, sometimes I've even crossed the line, but I know where I'm going, when I'll try to make it there, and hope God hears a sinner's prayer. Yes, I know where I'm going, and while I try to make it there, I know God still hears this sinner's prayer.
It's the first song I ever got to record from my meemaw right there. For my meemaw's request. We thank y'all so very much.
I love that.
Lives with me today.
Great song. I want to play one for you.
Is this a pitch?
Maybe.
I hope.
Only if you like it. You know, I don't know about you guys, but the world's just crazy right now. And I'm glad we're here tonight. You know what I mean? Like, there was a point in time where, I mean, everything just shut down. And just to be here tonight, I'm more grateful for it than I was before all this, you know, and I get that's one good thing that can come out of it is just being able to come sit up here and share these songs with you guys tonight, and I appreciate you being here. I wrote this one several years back with a friend of mine, and but to, you know, unfortunately, there's a lot of opportunities for that come up where I think about this song, and I wish there weren't, but there are, and so tonight I'm gonna play this one for the families of the 13 Marines that were killed recently over in Afghanistan, and for anybody here that has loved somebody that has put themselves in harm's way. My son had a buddy that was getting sworn into the Marine Corps, and his friend asked him to come to the ceremony to watch him get sworn in. And so I took him over to his buddy's house, and I dropped him off and went in and hugged the mom's neck and shook the dad's hand. And as I walked out, was getting back into my truck to head out of the neighborhood, I saw that young man's truck sitting in his driveway. And I just wondered how many trucks were sitting in driveways waiting for kids to come back to them. And that's how this thing got started. But I'll play this one for anybody here tonight that loves somebody that has served our country. There's a truck in the driveway, leaking oil, waiting for a young man on foreign soil. A dad on the front porch with his face to the breeze, and mom in the kitchen down on her knees again. And sometimes his best friend stops by just to say hi, runs his hand down the side of that truck as he passes by, and through the window as they're talking on the couch inside, he sees that worn out windshield sticker, Semper Fi. And in the blink of an eye, things get real, real fast, and nothing looks the same as things looked in the past. And the flag down at the schoolhouse, it still flies the same, but freedom is different with skin in the game. And life is easy when it's fireworks and apple pie, and learning what it all means as a parade goes by. But there are some things you can't fully understand till the taking of an oath and the raising of a hand. Then in the blink of an eye, things get real, real fast. And nothing looks the same as things looked in the past. And the anthem down at the ball game, it just don't sound the same. 'Cause freedom is different with skin in the game. Yeah, and you don't know the cost till there's a part of you that could get lost. And in the blink of an eye, things get real, real fast. And nothing looks the same as things looked in the past. And now that granite wall is more than just some list of names. 'Cause freedom is different with skin in the game. Yeah, freedom is different with skin in the game.
Yeah!
Have y'all had a good time tonight? Glen, I can't tell you thank you enough again for, you know, coming down here on a Wednesday night, braving the bus trouble and hopping in the car and still making it down here, man. Thank you for doing that for us tonight.
I'll do it again.
Matt, we'll have you.
I'd love it. Thank you so much for hosting this show, being such a great and a humble, just humble man. Y'all give Kyle another round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Heck yeah.
Thank you.
I'm glad to be here tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Glen. All right, well, what do you want to leave us with tonight? You got to leave us with something. I've heard requests. I've heard stuff being shouted all over.
We might have to be here for a few more minutes.
That's all right with me.
That's all right. Well, y'all, how about just a little clip of all of them? So how about this? Baby got a ball cap on, sure knows how to pull it off. Sun out of them hazel eyes, looking so good when she don't try. It's just an old worn out hat I've always wore turned back, but I couldn't help but laugh when she took it away from me. She don't know a thing about the Braves, and she could care less about the game. But if you saw her right now, you'd think it never belonged to me. Baby got a ball cap on, sure knows how to pull it off. Sun out of them hazel eyes, looking so good when she don't try. Acting like it's no big deal, smiling underneath that bill, and looking so right, it's wrong. Baby got a ball cap on, yeah, she got a ball cap on. One request right there. If you don't have one, make sure you make your way over there and get yourselves one. You only need the light when it's burning low. Only miss the sun when it starts to snow. Only know you love her when you let her go. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low. Only hate the road when you're missing home. Only know you love her when you let her go. Staring at the bottom of your glass, hoping one day you'll make a dream last. But
Dreams come slow and they go so fast. You see when you close your eyes, and maybe one day you'll understand why everything you touch surely dies. And you only need the light when it's burning low. Only miss the sun when it starts to snow. Only know you love her when you let her go. Only know you've been high when you're feeling low. Only hate the road when you're missing home. Only know you love her when you let her go. And you let her go.
They'll edit this one out.
An empty glass and the last cigarette. Closing time, and I'm drunk again. But somehow I'll make it home and cry myself to sleep. And that's the way the day ends every night for me. Every night I'm in some bar pouring whiskey on a heart that's on fire. Forgetting you is no easy thing. Each night for me always ends the same, with an empty glass and the last cigarette. Closing time, and I'm drunk again. But somehow I'll make it home and cry myself to sleep. And that's the way the day ends every night for me. Yeah, that's the way the day ends every night for me.
Yeah! With me. No, you won't.
Here's a little gospel for you. We'll finish with this one right here.
Hey, how about if he and I sing together, if Kyle and I sing together?
We'll try.
We're going to get y'all to sing too, right?
With some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to that home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Standing at my window on one cold and cloudy day, when I saw that hearse come rolling, Lord, to carry my mother away. How will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting, and the sky I said, Taker, Undertaker, Undertaker, please drive slow. Cause that woman you are carrying, Lord, I hate to see her go. How will a circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. There's a better home awaiting. In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Glen Templeton.
Thank you so very much. God bless you. Thanks for letting me be here tonight.